Professor Nikki Daliot-Bull from Hyper University, a very good friend of mine for a long time, and together with her, actually the Faculty of Theology has, how should I say, agreement, academic agreement between us and Hyper University, through which our students are visiting Haifa, and through which Haifa University students, just as we have an example here, are coming to Rosh Hashanah for 1 year to study. And my name is Ada Cohen, and I'm the director of SISMOR, and I'm very glad to present the title and contents of this lecture, but first I would like to say a few words about Nikki Bull. She's associate professor at the Department of Asian Studies at the University of Haifa, and until last year she was also the head of the Department of Asian Studies, and she's right now in sabbatical, which she's taking an opportunity to be at Doshi University as a visiting scholar. She has been a strong supporter of cooperation with Doshi University, and therefore we are very, very happy and glad to have her with us. She has received her BA at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem in 1991, and then in 1992 she has been in Osaka University of Foreign Studies as a research student, and then from 92 to 94 she has been to Tokyo University of Foreign Studies as in the graduate school, and then in 1998 she received an MA from Tel Aviv University, and in 2004 she received her PhD from Tel Aviv University, and since 2004, actually in between 2004 and 2006, she has been at Harvard University at the Reischauer Institute of Japanese Studies, and since then she joined the faculty at Haifa University. Her main interest is the cultural developments in Japanese society in modern times. And she's looking through the art of play, and recently through a look at anime borrowed from Japan to American culture, which has been written in her just recently appeared book. And you have the picture over there, and I have the book in my hand, which I will let you see during the lecture. And the title of the lecture today is Cross-Cultural Flows, Black Characters in American Animation, Anime-Inspired Cartoons and Anime. Please, Professor Daliot-Bull.
Thank you so much. Can you hear me well? So thank you all for coming. I'm really excited to see you. And I would like to begin by thanking Professor Cohen for inviting me to give a lecture today. This is not the first time I'm giving a lecture at the Distinguished University of Rosh Hashanah, but today is special because I'm celebrating and sharing with you the very recent publication of my new book, co-written together with Professor Ognaz Gin, The Anime Book in the United States, Lessons for Global Creative Industries. And I'll say a few words about my book before we go into the lecture. Am I speaking good? Not okay. So what we call the anime boom is really a certain period between the mid or late 1990s until exactly 2008, when the subprime crisis occurred in the U.S. And this was truly a golden age for Japanese anime on American television that generated considerable economic revenues, reaching a formidable peak in 2003. With almost $5 billion in sales. This is 3 times greater than the export value of Japanese steel production to the United States in the same year. While the sales of anime for television have dropped since, mainly due to saturation of low-quality anime series in the market, illegal downloading, the death of the DVD market in the United States, anime has become part, for many Americans, has become part of their mainstream culture. From a cultural point of view, the anime boom has widely influenced American animation and more broadly American youth culture. Anime introduced to American consumers a new set of visually stunning images, imaginative narratives, and artistic qualities which were not found earlier than then. They were not there before. So now I can hear myself too. Okay, sorry about that. So anime has particularly influenced American animation creators and producers who really took a great interest during those years in the topic. So if Walt Disney, the Fleischer Brothers, and other great American cartoonists had a big impact on Japanese anime during its incubating stage, in the 1990s and 2000s, Japanese animation exercised a great deal of influence back. This book is the product of 5 years' research. It aims to provide a comprehensive and empirically grounded study of the various stages of anime marketing and expansion in the US, and of the organizational and cultural processes which supports it, thereby describing a transnational embedded system for globalizing, distributing, and localizing commodified culture. We see the anime boom as an important chapter in a longer historical context. Drawing on in-depth interview with Japanese and American professionals in the animation industry, also in European and Israeli industries, field research, wild-scale market surveys, this book investigates the way in which anime, particularly television series, but also significant theatrical releases, was exported to the United States since the 1960s. So we think about it since the 1960s, but we actually argue that the anime boom was a very important landmark within this history. And as I said before, we explore the transnational networks of production, distribution, marketing of anime, as well as investigate the cultural and artistic processes it incited. Methodologically, the innovating underlying premise of this book is that in order to understand such a cultural phenomenon in global markets, one should look into the cultural and artistic content of media commodities as symbolic vehicles of meaning, as well as to networks of distribution, marketing, and to the particular industrial contexts that have shaped them. Analytically, we suggest that the rise and fall of the anime boom on American television was a reflection of the upheaval of media convergence revolution and of the intensifying relations between cultural creativity and commercial ambitions. To put it bluntly, you know, too much commercial pressure sort of killed creativity. So that had not a very good outcome. Our research, which was concluded in 2016, suggested that creative international co-productions were emerging as the most promising strategy for anime to cash on global opportunities. However, the organizational culture of the anime industry in Japan remains, with some exceptions, antagonistic to pursuing daring international collaborative adventures. If you go to anime producers, not all of them, but many would say, well, the local market is really big. We don't really care for overseas market. I think it is changing, but it is still an answer or a reply that you hear a lot. Now, if you're following the media news, and this maybe you have heard about Netflix's rather recent endeavor to produce original anime content. Have you heard about it? Yeah? So this is interesting, and actually it goes really along our argument in the book. Now, this could be a very interesting opportunity for anime in Japan, although I have to say that I'm a little bit suspicious, but we can talk about it later in the Q&A question if you'd like. But today, I would like to talk about one particular aspect that we developed in the book, not so much related to globalization, distribution, marketing, or organizational structures, but rather to cultural aspects of the interaction between the anime industry
and the American animation industry, namely the cross-cultural flows of images and the ensuing change in meanings of those images. So let's begin with some context. As I said before, the anime boom years in the United States were another chapter in the history of cross-cultural pollination between the anime industry and the American animation industry, in which the rising of Japanese anime as a global cultural center became pronounced, became overt, became celebrated. Japanese anime was imported to the US since the 1960s, and animators in the United States have been inspired by anime themes and styles at least since the 1980s. But it is during those years of anime boom that this inspiration became, as I said before, overt, pronounced, acknowledged, celebrated, so much so that a new genre of anime-inspired cartoons has emerged. I think in Japan, nobody really knows or heard about, or most people never heard about anime-inspired cartoon, according to my little research. Anyway, this is a genre that that was developed during those years, not only in the United States, also in Europe. In other words, I propose looking at anime-inspired cartoons, which I will explain in a minute, as part of a long process during which ideas, images, and representations have been crossing back and forth between Japan's anime industry and the United States animation industry. It has been argued and demonstrated that through various forms of hybridization and creolization, the meaning of externally originating goods, information, and images are reworked, syncretized, and blended with existing cultural traditions and forms of life. But in this context, anime-inspired cartoons offer a wonderful case study to explore how the adaptations and thereby displacement of ideas, images, and representations into new animated context may, and indeed often, change their symbolic meanings. In other words, I offer a study of cross-cultural adaptations. So what are anime-inspired cartoons? The term anime-inspired cartoon suggests an effort of non-Japanese studios to produce an animated show that prefers, reproduces, and even emulates that particular something found in anime that caught so many fans around the world, particularly at that point during the early 21st century. Considering the fact that anime has been a long influence on American animators, the neologism, or the new term, anime-inspired cartoon, should be understood first and foremost as a marketing tactic developed during the heydays of anime global popularity. In other words, studios, American studios, were using this term to attract more viewership. Here we are producing an anime-inspired cartoon, come and watch it, because anime was drawing so much attention. Among the first cartoons to be marketed in the United States as anime-inspired cartoon was the Powerpuff Girls. How much was it inspired by anime? Well, first you can see the design of the character, large head, big eyes. The music was probably inspired by Japanese music, I think you could say that. And particularly this story, because it's a story about three very, very little girls who are superheroes. And this kind of story you can find in Japanese anime, not so much in American cartoons. So the producers thought about it as something that is really reflecting anime in many, many ways. And the fact that how much, to what point they thought that this reflected anime or was Japanese-like, is reflected by the fact that a few years later, in 2006 actually, Cartoon Network reproduced the story or this cartoon as a Japanese anime together with Aniplex, which is owned by Sony, and with Toei Animation. And they changed the story, and as you can see, they also changed the design, but they called it Demashita Powerpuff Girls Zetto. I'm not sure how popular it was in Japan. I believe it was not very popular. But anyway, it's an interesting case of cartoon-inspired anime, if you want, although we never got that label. It seems that the label anime-inspired cartoons was always meaningless and unimportant for regular viewers of the television cartoons. I mean, if you don't know what anime, if you're not interested in anime and you're watching Powerpuff Girls, it doesn't mean too much to you if somebody tells you that it's anime-inspired, right? But for fans, This was very, very meaningful, and around 2005, anime-inspired cartoons became a favorite topic among global committed fans of anime on various internet venues, from defining the genre by deconstructing the constituents of anime in terms of style and theme, to creating devoted websites, to making databases of anime-inspired cartoons, to ranking anime-inspired cartoons. The topic has been sparking emotional exchanges among fans. Today, the use of the label anime-inspired cartoon by producers to promote new television cartoons in the United States is obsolete. Nobody does it anymore. And I think this reflects the fact that the anime boom on television is over, this one, but also the fact that anime style, anime design, anime storytelling technique is not the innovation it used to be anymore. In many ways, it's not part of the parcel American animators use anyway. So anyway, they don't use it anymore. In our work on the topic, we were able to define four categories of cultural interactions between Japanese anime and American cartoons. In other words, four categories in which you could see the influence of anime on American cartoons. So the first one was references to anime in American mainstream adult animated cartoons. I believe many of you are familiar with these adult anime, adult-oriented cartoons such as South Park, The Simpsons, Family Guy. These, of course, are not anime-inspired series, but what they did in the late 1990s is devote episodes to what they refer to as the invasion of Japanese popular culture into the United States, including the invasion of anime into the United States. And this is, of course, a satirical episode, and it's super interesting to watch and to see how they reacted to this boom. Another category that we were able to find were cartoons that go after Japanese-ness as fetish. Cartoon that, if you watch, you see, oh my god, this person, the person who created this cartoon is truly in love with Japanese culture. And I think these cartoon series were perhaps the best reflection of the cool Japan wave. So two examples on the screen right now. The one on your left is Hi-Hi Puffy AmiYumi Show. Maybe some of you are familiar. It was not so popular, but over the years it developed some kind of cult following. It's the story of a real-life duo rock singers, Puffy AmiYumi, who are Japanese. And in the show, they travel, they go on road trips from one performance to another, together with their manager, and of course they're Japanese, and you can see the design, big head, large eyes, colorful hair, the songs were sung in English and in Japanese, there were interjections in Japanese, and there were video clips of the real-life duo. So that was one interesting cartoon series. And the other one is Kappa Mikey, which was even less popular, I think, and I don't think it developed a cult following like I had Puffy AmiYumi. Kappa Mikey tells the story of Mikey, who is the red hair guy here, and he goes to Japan almost by coincidence, because I think he wins the lottery or something like that, and he joins a production team of anime in Japan. And the anime, the anime that he joins is not successful in Japan, but once Mikey joins it, it becomes a huge success. So this is really interesting, like it's an American going to Japan, making a huge success of an anime who is otherwise failing, yeah? The title of the series itself, Kappa Mikey, also tells you that whoever produced this show is very familiar with Japanese culture, because Kappa is the mythological, mischievous creature that lives in water and can be either very benevolent or very evil, right? So maybe it's the same with Mikey, who can be either very good or very bad. So another category, the third one that we were able to find, is are cartoons that truly tried to copy Japanese anime to the point of viewers not being able to distinguish. This was maybe the aim of the producer, although they would never acknowledge it. Not so many cartoons of that sort were produced in the United States. Many were produced in Italy and in France. Like cartoons that really, really, really tried to look like anime. In the US, it was not so popular. So I give you two. I brought two examples on the screen. This one is actually not American. It's a collaboration between Canada, France, and Japan. And you can see, you can just watch the poster and you can see how much it looks like anime, right? I don't have to even develop my argument here. Don't get confused because there's a Japanese company involved. The story was developed by Canadians. So it's really more non-Japanese than Japanese, but the result is a cartoon that really looks like Japanese. And the other example is Avatar, The Last Airbender. Maybe some of you know it. Maybe this is you don't know. You don't know. It's not known in Japan. This is very interesting. Avatar: The Last Airbender is probably one of the most successful and popular series or anime-inspired cartoon series that was produced over the years of those years in the United States. It's hugely popular not only in the United States, and by fans, it's considered to be maybe the best anime-inspired cartoon ever produced. And it's so Japanese not only because of the storytelling and because it develops from one episode to another as a mythical story, because of the design of the character, and also because of the color of the color palette used. Anyway, it's considered to be, it is a very good episode. It was also made into a live action movie a few years ago. The last category that we were able to define were cartoons that used anime style, storytelling technique, representation and images as point of reference, as inspiration to produce something hybrid and innovative. Personally, I think this is the most interesting category. So you see there's a creator of cartoons that really is inspired by anime, and he used something that he find interesting in anime to produce an original statement or an original work. And Samurai Jack is considered to be, or can be considered to be, a very good representative for this category. So Samurai Jack, as you can tell by the name, it's a story of samurai, so of course influenced by Japan. And the samurai, there is also something very anachronistic about the storytelling. Samurai Jack begins in feudal times and then moves to futuristic time, and there are robots and monsters and swords fighting. So there's a lot that can be said about how it was influenced by Japanese anime, but it's still very, very original. It is also considered to be a very, very good series, and only not a long time ago, another season was produced. So up until now, what I gave you is the context of my talk. We are at the first decade of the 21st century. Japanese anime, which has been an inspiration for American producers and creators for a long time, is becoming an open inspiration, a celebration, somewhat of a marketing strategy in the United States. Now I would like to get to the main part of my talk, in which I will present one anime-inspired cartoon. I will show how it was influenced by Japanese anime, and then I will go to the Japanese original and show you how this original itself is the product of many years of cross-cultural transference. At the end of my talk, I will return to the United States. So I hope that my journey I'm about to take is clear enough. So indeed, there is perhaps no better example to the process in which symbolic meanings change when cultural forms cross cultural boundaries than what happens to ethnic or racial representations when they cross borders. Because this is such a loaded issue. This is not just something that you can ignore. This is loaded. This is serious stuff. One example to that matter is the young adult-oriented, edgy, anime-inspired cartoon series, The Boondocks. The series is a social satire of African-American culture and race relations. It follows the lives of two young African-American brothers from inner-city Chicago, Huey and Riley Freeman, who moved to live with their grandfather in a suburb, mostly white suburb. Actually, the show joined other African-American-centered cartoons that have become less of a rarity since the turn of the millennium. Until then, there were, on American television cartoons, there were, of course, black characters, but maybe not so many series that centered on African-American life. And this has become more common since the beginning of the 21st century, and The Boondocks joined that trend. So Bundok's visual style, you can see here, but the Bundok's visual style, the Bundok's visual style is noticeably influenced by anime, as attested by the creator, Magruder himself, particularly by Cowboy Bebop and Samurai Champloo, both created by Shinichiro Watanabe. Both of these series are structured around multicultural and multiple cinematographic reference. They keep all the time referring to this movie, to this music, to that music. One major reference in both series is to Black American music, focusing particularly on jazz in the case of Cowboy Bebop, and on hip-hop in the case of Samurai Champloo. The influence of director Watanabe's style on the Bundoks is well discernible in the design of the main protagonists, and all the protagonists, all the characters in the series actually, the realistic settings and the battle sequences. It is also very noticeable in the opening sequences of the Bundoks that pay true homage to the visual style of the opening of Cowboy Bebop, with hip-hop music reminding viewers of Samurai Champloo. So as for the question, why anime? Magruder has replied, it's about the type of art for animation. I designed the characters in the original comic strip that way because I wanted it to be animated one day. And I knew that was the direction I wanted to go way back then. So in other words, you could say that Magruder was part of that generation that fell in love with anime, that really wanted to make anime, and this is how he expressed it. So that's a good enough answer, but I think that for us, thinking about why did an African-American creator, because Magruder is African-American, so why did an African-American creator of the Bundoks adopt Japanese stylistic representations of blacks in order to create an American sociocultural satire? This is interesting. I don't think this is transparent. This makes you think. And I think this is a good starting point to think about that ping pong between Japanese anime and American cartoons, that people of cultural transference that has started long before the Bundoks came to being. So what I propose to do now is, let's put aside the Bundoks, remember it, and move to the Japanese context and try to think about how representations of black developed in the Japanese context, both from a cultural point of view, and then we zoom in on the anime context. So the genealogy of black other in Japanese culture has been described with great insight by scholars such as Russell and Yano. Russell demonstrates how literary and visual representations of blacks in post-war Japan, at least since the 1950s, reveals the persistence of imported racial stereotypes which ascribe to blacks unflattering characteristics such as infantilism, primitivism, hypersexuality, bestiality, mental inferiority, psychological weakness, and so on. Aside from these racial stereotypes, Russell also finds a tendency, particularly in literary works, to employ the black other as a reflexive symbol through which Japanese authors such as Oike Zabudo or Yoshimoto Banana deal with their own ambiguous racial cultural status in a Caucasian-centric world. Put simply, in terms of the racial polarization between black and white, Japanese intellectuals, actually since the 19th century, were thinking about themselves as positioned in a liminal state between the so-called civilized white and the barbarous black. Now, this was further complicated by a clear distinction which was made early on by Japanese between African blacks and African Americans, who became, in a sense, an example of fellow people of color who could not belong to a modern and westernized nation. So there were, if you want, dialectical feelings towards the topic. Most interesting for the present discussion, however, Russell also points out that after the Vietnam War and following the rise of counterculture and the influx of black popular music and culture to Japan, disaffected Japanese youth came to see the African-American image as an image with which to counter the values of Japanese establishment, and the black other was adopted as a symbol of defiance and their own alienation from the Japanese mainstream. So what we see here from a very racist approach towards African blacks or African American blacks, we see a change that has developed probably since the maybe 1970s and onwards, as black Americans' culture became something that was adopted by Japanese youth to express their own alienation, their own defiance, their own non-conformism. And more than ever before, since the 1990s, adopting popular African American culture performative behaviors among Japanese youth in various popular subcultures has become very conspicuous, from the Ganguro, the Ganguro girls of the late 1990s, to use to structure their identities around reggae, rap, hip-hop rhythm, fashion, and cultural stances, to the rather eccentric anime director Shinichi Watanabe, not to be confused with Shinichiro Watanabe, who has been structuring a near-state persona for himself as Lupin III with an afro and some attitude. So anthropological interpretation, mapping the power structure obtained within the social worlds of Japanese youth who adopt African-American performative behaviors as they see them, and the relation between these social worlds and mainstream Japanese popular culture or culture actually vary. They range between suggesting that they are a means for identifying with other people of color, at least in style, to suggesting an all-out war against mainstream Japanese culture. So zooming in on anime, ethnic and racial representation in anime have drawn much attention among fans and scholars, not necessarily the representation of black in anime, but more so the non-Japanese of many characters that has raised many an eyebrow. In other words, you can watch Japanese anime and the characters don't look very Japanese. And many non-Japanese scholars and fans were noticing it and thinking, well, this is weird, yeah? So two explanations to the lack of dominance of Japanese ethnic characteristics in anime are accepted among scholars today. The first is that Japanese animation industry has always had the global market in mind and has been aware that the non-Japaneseness of character and stories, it's so-called mukokuseki, in Japanese it's called mukokuseki statelessness, works to its advantage in the export market. If a series doesn't look too Japanese, it is much easier to export. And it's very, very easy to domesticate to wherever. I mean, all you have to do is dub it, and that's it. The viewership anywhere in Israel, in the United States, the viewership will accept it as a local product. The second explanation is that anime characters may not look very Japanese, and yet they do not look white either. They look like anime characters. Their multicolored hair sometimes, their famous giant eyes, are not so much an imitation of Caucasian traits as expression of the graphic conventions of anime, which use physical attributes, for example, somebody very tall or somebody very short but still very strong, to convey feelings rather than as markers of ethnicity. Unlike in American cinema and animation, in which skin color is always political, in anime, ethnic representation are a fluid process. It seems that they are not so important. Arguably, however, unlike other characters, black characters are more often used in anime as an ethnic or racial marker of otherness, even for Japanese viewers. And I would even argue that the presence of black characters in anime may transform the ethnic identity of other characters as well. So if you see a cast of characters, anime characters, the question of ethnicity is not so important, but once you see a black character among them, it transforms the whole notion about how you see the other characters as well. So let's see now a few examples of how all of this exhibited in Japanese anime, or was exhibited in Japanese anime, at least since the 1960s. So maybe the Japanese know this series. Yeah, so one of the first representations of blacks in Japanese anime was in the 1966 movie Cyborg 009, which was based on a 1964 manga by the same name, which became a prequel to another film, completed a year later, and the 1968 series, both with the same name. And the anime series, television series, had two remakes in 1979 and in 2001. In other words, this is a very well-known franchise in Japan. Cyborgs 009 tells the story of 9 people who have been kidnapped from various locations around the world and turned into cyborgs by the evil, war-mongering Black Ghost organization. As the story begins, the cyborgs led by their creator, Dr. Isaac, Isaac Gilmore, break free and swear to combine their enhanced abilities for the greater good of human society. Cyborg 009, the last to be created and the most powerful among the cyborgs, become their leader. Cyborg 009 is Joe Shimamura. There he is. This is him and this is him. He's a young man whose mother was Japanese and whose father was an American GI stationed in Japan. Like Shimamura, who is a hafu, in a very ethnic conscious and foreigner shunning Japanese society, all the other cyborgs have been outsiders in their countries of origin. 001, who is here, is a very sick, pacifier-sucking Russian baby who was dumped by his parents. 002 is an American, he's an American with a big shaped nose who used to be a gang member. 003, here she is a French war orphan ballerina. 004, I believe this is him. His girlfriend was killed when the couple tried to escape from East Germany. 005, there he is a Native American who couldn't find work in the US due to widespread racism there. 006 is an impoverished Chinese farmer who tried to commit suicide before he was kidnapped. 007, we're almost there, this is 007, is an alcoholic ex-stage actor from Britain. And finally, the focal point of our attention, 008, whose name is Pyunma, is a runaway slave from Africa. The multi-ethnic, multinational cyber unit that is here to save the world embodies a strong political statement about the importance of international and interracial collaboration. This is particularly noteworthy if one considers the lack of civil rights movement in Japan and the strength of the homogeneous blood and cultural ideology in Japan. Confusingly, however, it is somewhat tainted by the openly racist visual depictions of the characters, especially the characters of color, the Chinese, the Native American, and the African. Look how Pyunma is portrayed, the African cyborg, yeah? This is how he is portrayed in the original manga. This is how he is portrayed in the first television series. This is how he is portrayed in the 1979 series, and look how he is portrayed in 2001. A great difference. In the original manga and the original movies and the first series and even the second series, Pyunma was portrayed with darky iconography of blackface. That is, googly eyes, inky skin, and exaggerated thick pinkish lips. Despite his ridiculous caricaturesque appearance, 008, who is a secondary character among the cyborgs, is a very serious, no-nonsense fighter. The darky iconography of blackface began in the United States in the 19th century by non-blacks who used a performance as a caricature of black people. It is very racist, and indeed, in the 1960s in the United States, following the civil rights movement, it was completely dropped. It was imported to Japan and became standardized at the turn of the 20th century, and it lingered here much longer after the 1960s. It is probably safe to assume that in a series that calls for collaboration among the races, this representation was chosen less from malice, from evilness, and more from ignorance, and from a deeply embedded endorsement of racist imagery that becomes so normal that the history and beliefs that it carries goes completely unmarked by most people. In light of growing awareness of the problematicalness of this iconography, and as a result of foreign criticism, darky iconography became delegitimized in Japan in the late 1980s. In the subsequent animated adaptation of Cyborg 009, like this one, Pyunma blackface was dropped in favor of a more natural appearance, And in this adaptation, he's no longer an escaped slave, but a guerrilla fighter. Now look what happened to him in the 2012 adaptation. Look how handsome he is.
Yeah.
But darky iconography lingered in Japanese anime. And Dragon Ball has Mr. Popo, Pokemon has Jinx, Shaman King has Joko. And that means that this is a very inconclusive list of blackface characters, and this suggests that awareness to embedded races in drawing blackface is still not universal in Japan. Moving forward more than 15 years from the original Cyborg 009 movie, the anime television series The Super Dimension Fortress Macross, the first series in the Macross franchise, became a milestone in the history of Japanese space opera. Relevant to our current discussion is Claudia LaSalle, here she is, a black female American bridge officer on the Macross Space Fortress in charge of weaponry and navigation. Although not one of the main protagonists, she makes her first appearance as early as the first episode as a capable officer and a good friend to Hayase Misa, there she is, who is a fellow female officer of Japanese descent and a main character. Claudia has the look of a black American and does not display the often accompanying racial attributes discussed by Russell. She gives the show a feel of ethnic diversity. As I said before, when there is one black character, the ethnic diversity of the other characters become more important. The ethnic diversity on the deck of Macross Space Fortress closely resembles, and not by coincidence, the ethnic diversity of American science fiction television series and movies. In particular, the Starship Enterprise of the Star Trek live action series and franchise from 1966. Aboard the Enterprise, the black woman Nyuta Uhura is an able communication officer and an important part of a multi-ethnic crew, reflecting the backdrop of the African-American civil rights movement, and in particular the Civil Rights Act of 1964. In fact, the actress who played Uhura, Nichelle Nichols, and Gene Roddenberry, who actually created the show, were celebrated for years after for giving space to the first ever positive role for an African American on American television. And until today, they are highlighted like that. The science fiction boom in 1970s anime was inspired by Euro-American science fiction with Star Trek franchise as a canonical television landmark. The creator Macross produced an original, very well-made, animated story with a good chance of selling overseas because it didn't look very Japanese. In fact, it looks American, and its use of a well-proven American space opera formula that was in vogue, duplicating the political statement on the multi-ethnic collaboration by creating a multi-ethnic crew, may have been, probably was, just a byproduct. Indeed, the 1985 American adaptation by the name of Robotech that combined the footage of two Macross series and another series by Tatsuya Nomura was hugely successful and actually proved that the mukokuseki, the statelessness strategy, worked. So we move forward again 15 years from the Macross to the anime series Cowboy Bebop, which I mentioned earlier as a huge influence on Magruder. And this series takes us to the realm of anime as a media territory that crosses an intermingled national boundary. This has truly happened somewhere in the globe, yeah? Director Watanabe described on several occasions that in addition to Lupin III, which is a very important Japanese anime film from 1971, Cowboy Bebop was largely his tribute to his favorite American movies and TV series, which were shown in Japan during the 1970s and 1980s, including Butch Cassidy, Sundance Kid, anything with Bruce Lee, anything with blues or jazz soundtrack, and lots of blaxploitation films. The tribute is performed in style, as well as in specific reference to specific movies or song. The series plot revolves around an unlikely multi-age group of penniless cowboy bounty hunters traveling with a space vessel Bebop in a futuristic world in which humans reside in outer space and travel in spaceships through space gates, but otherwise resembles very much the modern world of today if it was a Wild West. The series is action and character driven, The viewers are kept interested also because every episode offers a campy experimentation with movie genres and styles, complete with a range of references. Most relevant to our present topic, homage to blaxploitation movies is done by keeping the wide ethnic diversity in every episode, by using black music, as well as with specific references to specific movies. I think that it reminds me very much of Tarantino's movies. It's very postmodern, as I will explain later. In episode 17, called Mushroom Samba, the crew of Bebop are starving more than usually. They are very, very hungry. The episode is particularly nonsensical tale of how the youngest crew member, the preteen Ed, here she is, and the Ein, the dog, actually Ein is short for Einstein, are sent to look for food after the spaceship Bebop crashed in a barely inhabited desert that looks a lot like Utah. Ed and Ein soon meet Coffee, who is modeled after Pam Grier Coffee. And they also meet Shaft, who is modeled after Richard Roundtree, John Shaft of the movie, the exploitation movie Shaft, and is at the same time a reference to the 1966 spaghetti western Django protagonist by the same name, who drags around a coffin. You see the our movie, Dragging a Coffin, and this is the inspiration. Movie critic Simon Abrams is certainly right in arguing that there is very little philosophical meaning to the episode, unless you are a nihilist. Yeah. The episode works particularly well for those who recognize the campy intertextual references, Cowboy Bebop, self-reflexivity, unconventional structure, eclectic dialogues, ironic mix of humor and violence, non-linear story, cinematic allusions and pop culture reference in the form of homage and pastiche, turn it into an example of postmodern cinema, just like Tarantino movies. Within this artistic framework, the original cultural baggage of blaxploitation movies as a genre is not relevant at all. And essentially, blaxploitation films arose from the need of the black community to see films that reflected more their reality. The heroes were usually people who would normally be condemned in society because they were also sometimes pimps, drug dealers, pushers, informers, and prostitutes. Blaxploitation films fumed with anger. They were very angry. And the black audience sometimes was offended by these characters. But nevertheless, these characters were sexy, charismatic, dominant, and they were defiant. These anti-hero heroes were beating an unjust system, a feat that was near impossible in reality. So in Cowboy Bebop, with all these references, we are left with a frivolous teasing and loving play with globally circulating images without all of the political baggage that they carry. So my last example, in 2004, Shinichiro Watanabe directed Samurai Champloo, also an inspiration for the Boondocks. And this is an outrageous comedy adventure that features Tokugawa-era rappers, ink-brush tagging, Hiroshima homeboys, and sword fights using breakdance moves, another openly declared influence on the Buddha, as I said. In this character-driven anime, contemporary popular culture expressions are transferred to an uninhibitedly anachronistic past, creating a blend of hip-hop and samurai. The story revolves around three main characters. Two young sword master, Jin, a masterless samurai, raised in the old Bushido ways, and Mugen, a thug, raised among criminals in the Ryukyu Islands, whose fighting style is an undefined blend. The third lead character is a young woman named Fu, who will go through considerable efforts to recruit the first two to help her find a samurai that smells of sunflowers, who is, we will discover later, her father. And thus their quest begins. If there is one common point among the three characters, it is that they are very individualistic and challenging to any form of authority. There aren't any black characters in Samurai Champloo. What the series offers in abundance, however, is a contemporary adaptation of American black culture. Hip-hop, rapping, breakdance, fashion, Although the series takes place in anachronistic yet not entirely invented Tokugawa Japan, he talks about social cultural issues of present-day Japan, and even more importantly, of present-day Japanese youth. The series does create a web of contemporary conceptual possibilities that are very inviting to explore, among which one is particularly evident, that is the question of the precariousness or the instability of cultural identity in an intensively globalizing world in which cultural practice migrate uninhibitedly. Refocusing on the adaptation of American Black culture in this samurai tale, Watanabe said that one of the things that make samurai and hip-hop very similar is that in the old days, samurai felt very strongly about representing themselves with their one sword, and rappers today are also the ones who take one microphone and represent who they are. In other words, this blending of seemingly unmatching elements suggests a search for personal as well as cultural identity. The character that best parallels the hip-hop ideal is Mugen. His loosely hanging Japanese clothing look like hip-hop fashion. His unruly hairdo brings to mind hip-hop styling. His battling style brings to mind breakdancing. But most importantly, his defiant attitude and how he is proudly uncivilized and how he consistently doesn't follow any rule is an embodiment of an imagined black counterculture. This is a reflection of how black counterculture has become for contemporary young Japanese a cultural expression carrying the festivities of defiance, individualism, subjectivity, that celebrates friendship and bonding with others and that shuns conformity, homogeneity, and institutionalism. While representations of blacks in anime are a way to speak about Japan, as I think, I hope that you were able to notice in all those examples of Japanese anime in which the black other was portrayed, actually something has been said about Japanese culture and not so much about the black other. So while representations of black in anime are a way to speak about Japanese culture, Magruder was not trying to portray an ethnically other. Magruder in his The Boondocks is not really talking about an other Japanese in order to speak about himself. He was trying to write something or to say something about himself. So going back to The Boondocks, the series is very critical of the social, cultural, politics of African American and their relations with white America. Its dialogue with anime styles enhances the show's cool look and aesthetics at the height of the anime boom. For those in the know, that is, who are familiar with contemporary anime works, particularly those of director Watanabe, by referring to Watanabe, The Boondocks creates a social cultural critique of African American that nevertheless highlights positively the individualistic eccentricity, the resistance spirit that has come to be part of the construction of Black American culture in Japan also. So, I hope I'm making myself clear. What I'm trying to say is that there is a big difference. I mean, we see here a ping pong as one culture influences the other culture. But in Japan, they used representations of black as representation of others to say something about themselves. This is not what Magruder was trying, because he speaks about himself. He's just using the style to speak about himself in a better way. Yeah? Fitzgerald writes about merging of samurai culture and hip-hop culture in Samurai Champloo, arguing that one of the embedded messages of the show that explores cultural identity in an age of globalization is that globalization doesn't necessarily mean the belittling of one's culture. It is possible to remain true to one's culture while enacting it within the framework of a global modern society. In other words, you can remain and even be truer to being Japanese by enacting your Japaneseness through hip-hop. Hip-hop doesn't make you less Japanese. On the contrary, you can be even more Japanese by enacting hip-hop. The same can be said about Magruder's work. Magruder communicated, enacted, and enhanced the causes that define his own identity as a Black American with an important means of communication, namely with anime. And I think this is an important message in today's zeitgeist of complete anti-globalization sphere, to think that globalization does not necessarily belittle one's culture. it could actually empower one's culture. Thank you very much.